all the participants to the online 5-day faculty development program in behavioral economics organized by the Department of Economics, St. Bergman's College, Chennai, in collaboration with Kerala State Higher Education Council. Now we have our first technical session. Before starting this session, let me share some basic instructions for the smooth conduct of this FDP. All the participants should keep your camera and mic off during the session. Make sure that you will never switch to the presentation mode during the session. Kindly pin PPT from your side. There will be an interactive session towards the end of the lecture. Participants can either unmute their mic and ask questions directly or can type questions in the chat box. Especially for the YouTube viewers, you can type your questions in the chat box. Feedback form will be circulated in the last 10 minutes towards the end of this session. And I hope this session will be fruitful to all of you. And let me invite our resource person, Ashish Kulkarni, to start this session. Thank you. Wish you all a happy learning session. Thank you.
Ma'am, thank you so much for a very kind introduction to the principal, to Dr. Joyce, and to everybody in the team who organized the session. A, thank you for organizing it, and B, thank you so much for inviting me to kickstart the proceedings. I'm about to share my screen and start my presentation. I will speak as slowly as possible. If there are at any point of times any questions about the speed at which I'm speaking, if I'm inaudible, please let me know via the chat window, and I will try and correct things from my end. I'm about to start now. What I'm going to do is speak for about 40 minutes, then take a 5-minute break, and then speak for another 40 minutes, and then I'll answer as many questions as we can handle in the time that remains for us. The reason I'm taking a break after 40 minutes is because I'm a very big believer in the fact that no human being can concentrate for more than 40 minutes. We all need a break every now and then. So we'll take a break. It's 2:25 p.m. right now. We will take a break exactly 40 minutes later. All right, I'm going to get started now. I'm sharing my screen. And let's begin. So as they've already made clear on the very kind introduction that they've given, and I'll try and live up to that very kind introduction, I teach at the Gokhale Institute of Politics and Economics. I have been studying the topic of behavioral economics for many years now, and for a variety of reasons. It's a fascinating way to combine a whole host of disciplines, not just economics and psychology, in an attempt to understand not just how to understand economics better, but in fact how to understand small things in our own lives and how they impact our decision-making process and how our life changes for better and for worse as a consequence of these little nudges, so to speak, that take place around us all the time and impact us, like I said, in entirely surprising ways. I'm going to be as brief as possible in each slide in terms of content. So as you'll notice on each slide, there isn't a lot to read. But based on whatever is on the slide, I will speak a lot about that particular topic. And every now and then I'll keep checking in on the chat window to see if you have any questions that need immediate addressing. Otherwise, as was said in the introduction, I'll take most of the questions towards the end. Anybody who knows anything at all about either behavioral economics or about Richard Thaler will get the reference of this particular picture. But for those of you who are unacquainted with the topic of behavioral economics, and for those of you who are being introduced to this topic for the first time, let me explain why I have chosen to begin my presentation with a picture of cashew nuts. Way back in time, sometime in the 1970s, I think it was, Richard Thaler was hosting a dinner for some of his colleagues and friends. He had a pot roast in the oven and everybody was going to settle down for a nice hearty dinner. But while the whatever meat it was being cooked, he decided to serve his guests some cashew nuts. And it is something that has happened to all of us. All of us say, you know what, if you keep this bowl of cashew nuts in front of me, they are so tempting that I'll try and finish them right away and I'll feel good about that, but then I will not be able to enjoy dinner. And so what Richard Thaler decided to do is he decided to try and take the bowl of cashew nuts away. A, because he himself thought that would be important, and B, because his guests were saying that please take this away so that we will be able to enjoy the dinner that you're going to serve us. And there was a problem. The problem was, without the temptation of the nuts, A, we were happy about the fact that something that we were able to choose to eat was taken away from us. But herein lies a problem and a contradiction. We as economists were not allowed to be happy because, as all of us teach in our courses in economics, the first principle of economics is more is always better than less. So you can think of the old Pepsi tagline, Ye dil mange more. You can think about local non-satiation, which is how we refer to it in economics textbooks. But logically speaking, taking cashew nuts away from us ought not to make us happy. And the reason it ought not to make us happy is because it violates one of the very first principles of microeconomics, that of local non-satiation. So how is it possible that what we treat as axiomatic, what we treat as with one of the very basic assumptions, one of the very basic building blocks of economics, actually stands violated, but ends up making us happy? That's where behavioral economics, in a sense, stems from. It asks and attempts to answer the question, have we been learning and teaching economics in a slightly incomplete way? I will not use the word incorrect, but is there a richer, more nuanced understanding of economics than the basic building blocks that we have been learning and teaching where microeconomics and other fields of economics are concerned? So both in today's class and in tomorrow's class, I'm going to explore this question in some greater detail, the question of whether we can make our understanding of economics richer. If you read the literature associated with behavioral economics, if you speak to people who are skeptical of behavioral economics, people who doubt about whether it really is a field that merits a separate existence in its own right, they will say that this is old, that this has been around for a very long time. And they aren't wrong. In fact, the person we consider to be the father of modern economics, Adam Smith, himself was as much a moral philosopher and a student of psychology as he was a student of economics. So it is not at all under any amount of doubt, and I don't think it is controversial at all to say that economics had its birth in a much more rich and fertile environment where multidisciplinary approach was not just par for the course, but were in fact necessary. However, as economics started to evolve, the idea of this mythical, mystical beast called Homo economicus started to emerge, where a person would be completely rational and would take all decisions that would affect him or her perfectly, taking into account all of the information available and processing it faultlessly. But I certainly know that I'm not describing myself when I say something like this. I am gloriously irrational in my personal life, as I'm sure all of you are. And the point of behavioral economics is to acknowledge the fact that this is not just inevitable, but in some ways even desirable. Taking cashew nuts away from you before a good dinner is to be had actually makes us happy. Let's find out how and why. So let me begin with a small story. This is back when I was a student in Ferguson College, and I used to go to college on my motorcycle. And as the picture that you're seeing over here shows you, what I want to depict through this picture is I sometimes had to ride through rain in order to reach my college. And I faced an interesting problem, and I'm sure it is a problem everybody will identify when I describe it. When I'm riding my bike towards college and the rain starts to fall, I have two choices. I can either drive slowly, which will take me longer and I'll definitely get wetter, or I'll drive fast, in which case the rain will sting my face, will sting my hands, but I'll reach college sooner. So should I drive slower and get wetter, but not feel as much pain? Or should I drive faster, but therefore feel the sting of the raindrops on my skin? The good news is I reach college just a little bit faster. It might seem like a weird thing to begin a class on behavioral economics with, but in fact, Dan Ariely, and I'm going to share this presentation with all of you at the end of today's class, Dan Ariely has an entire blog about this. Who is Dan Ariely? Dan Ariely is a professor who's written a couple of books about which I'll speak later. He's run lots of fantastic experiments, which I'm going to refer to in this particular talk. And he is a person who has done more in the last, I would say, around two decades or so to further the boundaries of behavioral economics than perhaps most other people, although not all. The post that I've linked to at the bottom of this particular slide, it speaks about how Dan Ariely, when he was 17 years old, was caught in an accident in which magnesium fireworks exploded literally in front of his face. He was to, at that tender age of 17, experience 70% burns on his body. The blog post that you are going to be looking at when you click on this particular link, it speaks about both the pain that he went through and the horror that he went through when he found out how he had been disfigured as a consequence of that explosion. The good news, however, is that he analytically learned how to think about pain and pleasure, psychology, and in a certain period of time, economics, as a consequence of that accident. Turns out when he had that accident, he had to be bathed daily and his bandages needed to be replaced daily. When you're grafting new skin onto a body and you need to pull apart the bandages, it is extremely painful. All of us have experienced the pain of trying to rip a bandaid out from our own bodies. We know how much it pains when you rip out a bandaid. Imagine that being done when the skin is being grafted. The nurse, Dan Ariely used to say, would always peel off the bandage very quickly and it would cause a lot of pain to Dan Ariely. One of the first experiments he ran when he started to get slightly better is he asked for a slightly higher amount of control about whether the bandages should be peeled off slowly or rapidly and where the bandages should be peeled off first. What I mean by that is, imagine, and hopefully all of you can see my right forearm right now, imagine that you have a bandage over here. Should I start with the most painful part of the body first or the least painful part first? What Dan Ariely found out is he typically enjoyed or rather felt lesser pain when the bandage was peeled off slowly, number one, and number two, when it was peeled off in such a way that the most painful part of the body was relieved first. So if you want to peel off a bandage, peel off the most painful part first so that you end with a happy memory. What is my discussion of the motorcycle in the rain or Dan Ariely's much more painful expression of peeling off bandages have to do with behavioral economics? A worthy question to ask and think about is, how does our perception of pain and how does our decision to handle pain translate into, say, for example, financial decisions? Do people who feel that peeling off bandages slowly also tend to choose home loans with a higher duration? Do people who prefer to ride bikes fast in the rain prefer a shorter home loan duration? So you will have to pay a higher EMI, but the good news is for a slightly lower number of years. That might be like driving a bike fast. Or it may be that I prefer the home loan to last for a longer period of time, but not as much pain or financial burden on a per month basis. Does that correlate with, say, for example, peeling off bandages slowly? How we decide to view pain in other areas of life, does it have an impact on how we view financial pain? Is one example, and hopefully one that all of us can correlate with, in terms of how to think about behavioral economics. Our attitude towards pain, our appetite for pain, and our tolerance for pain might translate into financial decision making as well. And that's a direct example, one that I've tried to correlate with what Dan Ariely spoke about, that helps us understand why studying behavioral economics is important, because how we deal with pain might have natural impacts, might have natural implications, repercussions on how we deal with a whole variety of economic problems. So what exactly is behavioral economics? The definition that you're seeing on your screen right now has been picked up from Wikipedia, nothing very complicated at all. And I'm never in the habit of reading out stuff that all of you can read out yourself. So I'm not going to bother reading out this sentence, but I will emphasize the words that I have chosen to put in color over here. Like I said, the definition has been taken from Wikipedia. Feel free to take a look at the entire Wikipedia article later. It's a fairly well-written article, but let me emphasize the five factors that you see on the screen right now. Behavioral economics says that decision-making by individuals isn't always necessarily rational, but it is also impacted by psychological factors, which I just described on the previous slide, cognitive factors, which is what tomorrow's talk is going to be entirely about, emotional factors. Let me give you an example of emotional factors. I will not tell you the name of the person who told me this. I will not tell you the firm where I learned about this. But I was once speaking to a person from HR, and that person told me that they always prefer to conduct employee satisfaction surveys on Friday afternoons rather than any other point of time during the week. And why? Because HR knew that when people came back from team lunches, which typically tend to happen on Friday afternoons, they feel much more relaxed and happy, and therefore tend to give better responses to a survey that asks, how happy are you in office? If you think about it, it makes sense. If, say, for example, the college that you're affiliated with asks you how happy are you with working in that particular college, you might give different responses based on Monday mornings and Friday afternoons. That is, emotional effects have some sort of an impact on the decisions made by individuals and institutions. You yourself can come up with examples in terms of cultural impacts, in terms of social impacts, but the point is, our decision making is never at any given point of time devoid of, independent of what is going on around us. And the reason why I'm saying this to you is because we should therefore keep in mind each of these factors when we ask how will a certain decision impact society at large. What you're about to take a look at on the screen is an example from Dan Ariely's experiments. Let me explain the context. As you might have figured out already by taking a look at the picture, this is a holy book. Doesn't matter which religion. Imagine any holy book. And here's the context behind sharing this picture with you and explaining what I'm speaking about. Dan Ariely once ran an experiment in which he conducted an exam in his university. So he walked into a classroom where students were waiting. He distributed the question paper, distributed the answer paper. And then he left the classroom and he said, I'll be back in an hour. The students were confused to begin with, but then they realized that there was to be no invigilation. Nobody was going to be supervising them. So some students started writing and some students, all of us as people in the education sector will know that there will be some students who will copy if there is no invigilation that is being done. And so the copying started. Here is where things get interesting. Dan Ariely also conducted exactly the same exam in another classroom, where also he walked in, distributed the question paper, distributed the answer paper or answer sheets, and left the classroom. There also, students realized that there was to be no invigilation, but there was one important difference. And that difference was the fact that in the second classroom, Dan Ariely left a copy of, I think it was a Bible, on the table. That's it. Nothing else apart from that. What did the Bible do? The Bible did nothing. It sat there on the table. But suddenly, all the students in class felt as if they were being supervised. There was no human being. There was no camera. There was no actual supervision happening. But just the placement of a book that people considered to be holy on that particular table impacted how people wrote an examination. It explains why you want to have a small religious idol or a small place of worship in your homes. It's not as if Dan Ariely discovered the fact that keeping a small religious memento on your desk or in your home tends to make you behave better. This has been known by anthropologists for centuries together. But the important part that we want to understand over here is cultural and social factors, psychological, cognitive, and emotional factors will have an impact on the decisions of individuals. What does classical economic theory say? Classical economic theory says that all of these, say for example, keeping a Bible on the table or keeping any holy book on the table, should not have an impact on the decision making of rational individuals. Why then does it have an impact? Precisely because of what we are speaking of. Whether it is the peeling off of bandages, whether it is deciding to drive fast or slow in the rain, whether it is deciding whether or not to take a low tenure home loan or a long tenure home loan, or whether it is to copy or not, when a book is kept on a table in the room in which you're giving an exam. Each of these are examples of psychological, cognitive, emotional, cultural, and social factors that impact the decisions of individuals and indeed institutions. So in the first couple of slides that I wanted to share with you in today's presentation, I wanted to drive home the fact that we are impacted by a whole host of these things that play on our minds on a daily basis. Behavioral economics asks, can we be systematic about thinking about how these factors impact decision making? Are there certain biases? Are there certain heuristics? That's just a big fancy English word that means thumb rule. Are there thumb rules? Are there fallacies? Are there assumptions? Are there typical ways in which we know or can predict that individuals will respond to certain stimuli, will respond to certain factors? And can we study this systematically in order to reach some sort of an ability to make systematic predictions about how human beings will behave? That, for better or for worse, is one way of understanding exactly what behavioral economics is. It is, once again, the impact of each of these factors, psychological, cognitive, emotional, cultural, and social, on our decision-making ability. So in tomorrow's class, In tomorrow's webinar, which will begin at the same time on Sunday afternoon, I will speak about A, framing effects, and B, inefficiencies, but in much more detail about what are known as heuristics. So tomorrow's class is going to be focused on how to think about each of these three things: heuristics, framing, and inefficiencies. We'll get to exactly what these are, like I said, in much greater detail in tomorrow's class. For the moment, I want to give you some sort of a backdrop or background to how to think about behavioral economics, give you some sense of the history of the development of behavioral economics, and then we'll take a look at a whole variety of examples. Hopefully most of them will be fun, about how we can use behavioral economics to make our society better. Some of you might be confused right now about the reason for showing you a pair of scissors on the slide. Where does the scissor come from? The scissor is a metaphor, was an analogy that was used by a Nobel Prize winner, I'll tell you his name in just a little while, who said that you might think of the human brain as having two blades on a scissor. The first problem that the human brain has is that there are cognitive limitations. What exactly are cognitive limitations? Let me give you an example of what a cognitive limitation is. This example is not my own, although I myself have a couple of examples from my own life. But like I said, right now, the example I'm going to give you is not from my own life. It comes from a guy called Barry Schwartz, who speaks about in a wonderful TED talk how difficult it is to buy a pair of jeans. So he needed to replace an old pair of jeans. He walked into a clothing store and he said, "I want a pair of jeans." So the shopping assistant says to him, "Well, all right, sir, what color do you want the jeans in? What style do you want the jeans in? Do you want carrot top jeans? Do you want bell bottom jeans? Do you want flaring jeans? Do you want faded jeans? Do you want dyed jeans?" The number of options was so much that Barry Schwartz said, "You know what? I can't handle this. This is too much choice to think about." And he actually left the shop without buying a pair of jeans. That's cognitive limitations. When you give a person too much choice, the person actually tends to respond by not choosing. Sounds weird, but I'm able to verify this myself. How am I able to verify this? In the year 2007, this was my first trip to the United States of America. I was in a city called Boston and I walked into a supermarket to buy milk. This was the year 2007. I didn't have a smartphone with me. This was the pre-internet and pre-smartphone era. So I take my shopping cart, I go into the supermarket and I walk down the aisle where milk is kept. And I actually left the shop that day without buying milk. Why? Because if you've ever been to America and if you ever tried to buy a carton of milk, you'll know how difficult it is. There was 2% milk, 3% milk, 5% milk, 7% milk, and I didn't know what the percentage stood for. There was almond milk, there was soy milk, there was flavored milk. It was just an endless range of options. I actually went back home, opened up my computer, figured out what it is that I wanted to look for, and then went and bought stuff. But the number of choices was just too much. Dan Ariely, in fact, has a video in which he speaks about how an experiment was run with doctors, where doctors were told, "All right, this is a patient." Was there a question? Mr. Gaurishankar Beriha, if you could please mute your phone or computer, please. Thank you. Okay, and since I've come over here on the other window, let me just go through the questions and see if there are any. So Manan Joshi has a question about the link in the chat box. I will be sharing this entire presentation. You will have access to all the slides, so you can obviously open up the link then. And Malika MG has a question, why more crimes in countries where majority are religious than those countries where people moved away from religion and moved towards science? That takes us, Malika MG, into very deep waters. Does religion have an impact to play over there? Possibly. But all that we're saying right now is, in a classroom, the keeping of a Bible on a table is a SIF in the language of Richard Thaler. SIF is an abbreviation that stands for supposedly irrelevant factor. And Thaler coined that phrase to say, technically speaking, by the definition of economics, the fact that a Bible is there or is not there ought to be an irrelevant factor. But of course, the fact that people have chosen to not copy because the Bible is kept on the table makes it a relevant factor. The question of whether religious countries tend to be more crime-riddled or less is a very interesting one, but not one that is related to the topic at hand right now, which is why I would love to speak about it, but perhaps not in the context of this particular class. And Vibha Gupta, yes, what we're speaking of is exactly the choice paradox. The fact that giving people more choice tends to make them not choose. So the experiment that I was speaking of is an experiment, and it's, if you think about it, a slightly frightening one. One in which Dan Ariely ran, or whether it was he or somebody else, I don't know. But the experiment was this. A doctor was given a case study and asked, for this particular patient, would you recommend hip surgery or not? Now, hip surgery is a fairly complicated procedure. Typically and ideally, a doctor will want to explore all other options before recommending hip surgery. When the doctor was given a limited number of things to do before trying hip surgery, so say for example, you can give medicine A or medicine B, then the doctor would think about it and choose what he thought was the best medicine to give to the patient. But if you gave more than two choices, if you gave, say for example, 10 choices, you can try medicine A, B, C, D, E, or any medicine until J, or go in for hip surgery, then most doctors chose hip surgery. So rather than work through all of the options and choose what is best for you, let's simply take the easy way out and not choose. So whether it is doctors choosing or not choosing to give medicines, whether it is Barry Schwartz buying or not buying jeans, whether it is I, Ashish, buying or not buying milk, or a whole variety of other examples, they are all examples of our cognitive limitations. Strain the brain too much and the brain tends to not choose at all. The second blade on this particular scissor is structures of the environment. So when you are faced in an environment in which your brain has cognitive limitations, you tend to take a look at how the environment is structured and choose accordingly. If you are unclear about what structures of the environment are, the next slide will explain this in slightly greater detail. For the moment, just take it as a given that our brain does two things. It tries to understand how much it is able to process of the information, and it tries to look for cues or clues in what it sees around it to arrive at a decision. The example of the two blades of the scissor and their labels, structures of the environment and cognitive limitations, is due to the gentleman you see on your screen right now. His name was Herbert Simon. Won the Nobel Prize for Economics, if I'm not mistaken, in the year 1977. I could be wrong about the year. And the speech that he gave and his biography is available on the link that is shared towards the bottom of the screen. And again, for those of you who might ask on the chat window, this entire presentation will be shared with you at the end of this presentation. So you can, of course, click on the link then. But what he spoke of is something that actually predates Thaler, predates Kahneman, predates Tversky, all of whom are people who are recognized as experts in the field of behavioral economics. But Herbert Simon had figured out that we have the inability to process information completely. And he said, what we do is we satisfy ourselves. Satisfier, the spelling is slightly different, and this particular website should tell you the correct spelling in the context of Herbert Simon. Satisfiers are people who are not rational, people who are not irrational. There is bounded rationality. And what that means is we try to be as rational as possible, but beyond the point, we can't help but be irrational. Irrational is a dangerous or loaded term to use, but basically what I'm saying is, given the environment around us and given the kind of choices or cognitive load that we can put on our brains, we try our best to be rational, but at some point we have to almost of necessity give up and say that things are now beyond our control. Now we are not going to try and process information. We're just going to do with what we think is best. For example, and the picture that you're taking a look at right now is related to the structures of the environment. For example, one way to think about structures of the environment is this. Now, what you're looking at on the photo is obviously some sort of a cafeteria or a buffet meal at some place. And the important thing to understand is not just what is in the foreground over here, but also what is in the background. So the buffet doesn't end over here. You can go to the next aisle and there are some other things to eat in the background. And further, there is a third aisle that you might be able to see in the background where there is still more food to eat. Now, that's a lot of cognitive load. Should I eat whatever is in this aisle or the next aisle or the aisle after? How do I reduce the cognitive load? How do I change the structure of the environment? What I could do is I could put up a notice saying healthy salad choices here. So now all of the options are still available. Right? So if you think about the two blade to the scissor, the cognitive limitation is my brain trying to process, should I have carrot, should I have zucchini, should I have whatever other vegetables are over here, or should I go over to the next aisle or the aisle after? I might end up worrying about whether I should take this or that. But now the structure of the environment has been changed for me. There is a message that has been placed over here, healthy salad choices here. This, in the language of Richard Thaler and Cass Sunstein, is a nudge, is a push. If a person takes his or her tray and reaches this aisle first, rather than reach the other aisles, and this aisle has a message saying healthy salad choices here, then is it likely that a person will load up on the food that he or she sees over here rather than go to the next aisle? And if so, then using the example of Herbert Simon's framework, we have given a lot of cognitive load, but we've also changed the structure of the environment. Or to give it its more modern name, what we are indulging in is paternalism, where we are trying to push people into making a choice, not forcing them to make a choice, but we're pushing or nudging them into saying, well, all of these options are available, but why not choose this one? This one is good for you. That's an example of how to think of what Herbert Simon was thinking about in the 1950s. Now, what are more modern examples of behavioral economics? In order to walk you through the more modern examples of behavioral economics, what I'm going to do is I'm going to refer to the two slides that are going to come up next, and I'm going to give you two fairly simple problems. The first problem that I'm going to give you is the following one, and it's going to be so simple that you're going to wonder what is up. But humor me and try and solve it. You guys know the answer to this, right? It's obvious, it's 4. And perhaps some of you are worried right now about why you're attending such a very basic presentation. We're being asked to answer 2 plus 2 is equal to what? But there is another trick up my sleeve, and here is the other trick up my sleeve. Try and solve this problem, 13 into 43. What is the context and why am I asking you to solve these problems? 2 plus 2 for everybody on this call is a problem that you've solved so often since you were a child that you have thought about at least a million times by now, that you no longer have to engage your brain to think about what might be the potential solution. It just, there's a part of your brain that just lights up and says 2 plus 2 is 4. That's all there is to it. There is no thinking, there is no processing, there is no effort that is happening. On the other hand, if I ask you what is the answer to the problem 13 into 43, then you might enter or encounter a problem. Your brain doesn't have the answer ready-made. It is not immediately available. So when your brain sees this problem, 13 into 43, it says, well, all right, here is a problem I'm not able to solve. So what it does is it starts to focus on this particular problem. And by the way, the focusing happens without you knowing that your brain has decided to focus on it. But there is an interesting thing that happens in your physiology, not your psychology. There is an interesting thing that happens in your physiology. It is the fact that your pupil dilates. Whether you like it or not, when you start to think about a problem where you're actually concentrating, your pupil goes bigger. Why does it grow bigger? That's an interesting evolutionary problem. The reason it grows bigger is because from an evolutionary viewpoint, we as a species, and in fact all species, have been trained to respond to a problem by gathering as much information as possible. When we make our eyes big, it is literally a minor stress that is being placed on our body. Our brain is saying, here is a problem that requires our full attention. And full attention in all of our bodies effectively means trying to gather in as much information as possible. And from an evolutionary viewpoint, back when we were in the jungles, we had no choice but to try and get as much information as possible by expanding our pupils, by dilating our pupils. That backdrop remains with us even today. Daniel Kahneman, the person who won the Nobel Prize in Economics for his insights into behavioral economics in the year 2001-2002, he said, or rather he ran a series of experiments where he gave people a series of problems to solve. Easy problems, such as, say, for example, what comes after the letter A in the alphabet? How much is 2 plus 2? Pick up your right hand. Each of these was so simple that the pupil would not dilate. But when the person was given a slightly more difficult problem to solve, such as, say, for example, 13 into 43, then whether you liked it or not, it was involuntary, but your pupil would dilate. Not just that, the best way to find out when you stop thinking about a particular problem was by seeing when your pupil would, so to speak, undilate itself. It would become smaller. That was your brain saying, give up. I don't know how to solve 13 into 43. What does each of these mathematical problems have to do with behavioral economics? Like I said, they were the discovery of the guy on the right. The people you're looking at in this photograph, their names were Amos Tversky. That's a gentleman on the right, and the gentleman holding the book. So when I say right, from their perspective, so let me be clear. The person who's holding the carafe of wine over here, or whatever it is that they are drinking, this person is Amos Tversky. And the person on the right over here, in a white shirt, holding the book, his name is Daniel Kahneman. Both of them were pioneers in the field of behavioral economics, as we understand it in a modern sense. And what they did is they effectively figured out a way of how to understand from a systematic viewpoint the biases that exist in our brains, the mechanisms that exist in our brains. And this particular picture, system one kind of thinking and system two kind of thinking, is due to Daniel Kahneman's experiment. What is system one thinking and system two thinking? Take a look at the purple side of this particular diagram. It has words like intuition, involuntary control, effortlessness, innate skills, speed, and reflex. Now, if this was an actual class, I sometimes at this point of time prefer to just, as a matter of surprise, take a ball out of, say, my pocket and throw it to somebody in class. Your natural instinctive reaction is to put your hand up to catch it. You can't help it. It's just the way your brain functions. That's what we mean when we use words like reflex, speed, or effortlessness. If I throw a ball at you right now, you are going to put your hand up to catch it. That's just going to happen whether you like it or not. That's system one thinking. 13 into 43 is system two thinking. D by dx of x cube plus 4x3, that's system two thinking. That requires patience. That requires concentration. That requires constructed thoughts. It requires analytics. It requires effort. It requires reason. System two thinking is taxing to the brain. We can't do too much of it. Our brain isn't wired in a way that it can always at all points of time indulge in system two thinking. Our brain gets tired, which in fact is why we're going to have a break in just a little while. The reason we're going to have a break is because if I ask you to engage system two thinking for more than 40 minutes, then your brain is going to feel tired. And at one point of time, your pupils will start to undilate. You will start to dream about, say, for example, a hot cup of coffee. You'll start to ask questions such as, when is this session going to be over? That's your brain shifting away from system two thinking into system one thinking, where it is based on intuition, which is based on speed, but you're not able to do deep thinking. And like I said, the reason I bring this up is because what Daniel Kahneman said is one way to test whether your brain is in system one or system two thinking is by taking a look at your pupils. Most of the time, we as human beings have resorted to system one thinking. It's quick, it's efficient, and we don't think too much about it. Unfortunately, also as a consequence of this, our brain has this almost pitiful ability to be fooled by whatever it sees around it. Unless you tell your brain that, all right, whatever information you see around you, we're going to think carefully 10 times about it before reaching a decision. That is, if we tell our brain to remain in system two all the time, we will be susceptible. There will be a risk that we will end up making a slightly incorrect decision because we are trusting our brain to do what it thinks is right. That's the lazy, quick part of our brain. If you want the unlazy, much more stronger part of our brain, the good news is we can deploy it, but only for a certain period of time. And that's the difference between system one and system two thinking. If you've heard of a book called Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman, it's a great book to read, and I'll speak about it in greater detail towards the end of today's class. Thinking fast is basically system one thinking. Thinking slow is essentially system two thinking. Most of what I'm going to speak about in tomorrow's class, in Sunday's class, is in a way related to system one thinking. What are the biases? What are the heuristics? What are the thumb rules? What are the fallacies that our brain is almost perennially subject to when it is engaged in system one mode? Like I said, is a topic of tomorrow's class. Okay, I started speaking at 2:25. It's almost close to 3:05 now. So I'm going to pause for a minute in the sense that I'm going to take a look at whatever questions you people have asked. Then let's take a 5-minute break and then let's come back and continue with the rest of the session. So just give me a second while I read some of the questions. Boy, there are a lot of questions. I might not be able to answer all of them right now, but let's answer a couple and then take a break. Manan Joshi has an example of a nudge about reducing sugar consumption among young students. Yes, Manan, absolutely. I will not be speaking about this example in today's class, but it's a classic example of a nudge. This call is being recorded and hopefully will be shared with everybody, so you can take a look at the comments yourself later. Vibha Gupta has a question. Doesn't cognitive load and structure environment make behavioral economics highly subjective? By definition, Vibha, behavioral economics is highly subjective. Because like you said, the fact that my brain and your brain is wired differently, and by definition it is, perhaps you have the ability to engage in cognitive load for far longer than I do. So our tolerance levels and when an individual brain shifts into system one or system two thinking differs based on each individual person and a whole host of other traits besides. So yes, it is entirely subjective, but that's not a flaw to me. That's what makes behavioral economics so very interesting, because if this is true, then trying to say that every person will react in a similar way to a given environment isn't true. And that means economics perhaps is not as rich as we should hope for it to be. There is another question. How close is behavioral economics to Gandhian economics? Because only Gandhi talked of ethics where economics was discussed. I don't think it is very close to Gandhian economics in the sense that behavioral economics makes no value judgments about how you will use your biases. So, will you tend to be more greedy about consumption stuff? Will you tend to be more a urban dweller or a rural dweller? There is no systematic way of predicting this. Neither does behavioral economics say that this is definitively better or worse than the other. Gandhian economics, on the other hand, has a very strong preference for, say, for example, a village-oriented economy or not focusing on consumption so much or self-reliance. Whatever our own individual opinions about Gandhian economics, I would say it is not related to behavioral economics. But Mr. Deshpande, if you're interested in this topic, I'm sure you've already read the book, but one of the best books that I have read in this regard is Small is Beautiful by E.F. Schumacher. If you have other books that you'd like to recommend to me and other people on this call about Gandhian economics, please, we would love to hear from you. Okay, let's do two more questions and then take a break for coffee. So the first question that I'll deal with before we take the break is, how can nudging help when meal is served during weddings? This may be lame, but this may help in avoiding food wastage and better decision making. Navneet, great question. And there is, you might be happy to hear, already a solution available with us behavioral economists. Give as much food as you want on the buffet table, but give smaller plates. So if you have to walk up to the buffet station repeatedly to fill up your plate again and again, that might act as a nudge for you to take smaller portions. If you keep a lot of food and keep big plates, then that ends up making people eat more. But if you keep a lot of food, which you have to as the host of a wedding, but keep smaller plates, then maybe it'll work out fine. And people might feel either ashamed or lazy or embarrassed about having to go again and again to the buffet table, and they'll end up eating less. I hope that answers your question. Like I said, let's just do one more and then take a 5-minute break. If behavioral economics is more accurate, why study classical economics? If you ask me for my opinion, I'm not very interested personally in the debate of who is right or who is wrong, behavioral economics or classical economics. To use the language of economics itself, I don't think of them as substitutes for each other. So it's not as if you study one, you should not study the other. Think of them as complements. You need to study both. So if you say, I study only neoclassical economics but will not touch behavioral economics, I will argue your view of the world is slightly poorer. On the other hand, if you say that I'm going to study only behavioral economics and all of classical economics is wrong, then it makes the analysis of society itself that much more intractable or difficult. It's much better, I would argue, to remain somewhere in the middle. Man tries to be as rational as possible, or society tries to be as rational as possible, but doesn't always succeed. Herbert Simon and the satisficing approach, I think it's something positive going for it. Okay, there are a lot of other questions, but like I said, I don't want to engage you guys in system two thinking for a very long period of time. It's 3:07. We will take exactly a 5-minute break and then come back and deal with the rest of the course. Yeah. So in exactly 5 minutes, we'll start again. It's 3:07. We'll begin at 3:12. Truly awesome questions, and I'm not being polite. some of them have forced me to think about how to try and answer them. I'll begin with Pratik Sengupta's question. Can mindfulness meditation make us better behavioral economists? I wish that were true, Pratik, but I think it makes us better human beings, but not necessarily better behavioral economists. Nishat, Anjum has a question. Modeling of human behavior might take away the peculiarity of individuals' actions. I don't think so, Nishat. It helps us understand circumstances under which systematic biases reveal themselves. We are not at all suggesting or recommending that people change their actions. We are simply showing a mirror to society that this is how you have, whether you like it or not, certain biases, certain patterns, certain heuristics within you. It's up to you to decide whether you want to change them or not. So I would be uncomfortable as labeling a fallacy or labeling a heuristic as either being wrong or good. Rather, I think we should just state that it is there. And it is up to each individual person about whether they want to change it or not. I hope I'm pronouncing the name correctly, and my apologies if I am not. Stefij, S-T-E-F-Y-J. I'm really sorry, I'm not sure how to pronounce your name, and my apologies if I didn't pronounce it correctly. A fascinating question about the teleological theory of ethics. Now, for everybody else on the call who may not be familiar with philosophy, teleology essentially, and whoever asked the question, correct me if my understanding is wrong, but teleology effectively says that you judge an action not on the basis of whether it is good or bad, but on the basis of what outcome results through this particular action. Or put another way, it's an age-old debate about means and ends. There are two different theories of ethics as far as I understand them, teleology and deontology. Deontology is where actions are judged as good or bad for themselves, not in terms of the outcomes that they have. So the question is, although the theories are explained from a rational perspective, is it more of bounded rationality? I would say no, and the reason I would say no is because each individual person will decide for himself or herself what the impact of your actions are going to be. And that process itself probably is not going to be rational. So I don't think they are related subjects. It's a fascinating topic to think about, the ethics of teleology and the ethics of deontology, but I would say they are not related to behavioral economics. There are a couple of related questions about whether system two thinking can become system one thinking. And there are at least two people who've asked this same question. Let me answer it in some detail. Absolutely, yes. Some system two thinking can end up becoming system one thinking. I have a daughter at home, she's 7 years old. And I literally get to see this happening. How? Because she's learning mathematics and tables, multiplication tables right now. And it's fascinating to see how she has to think or had to think until a couple of months ago about what, say, for example, three threes are. But now it's become system one thinking for her. Three threes are nine. And she doesn't have to think about it anymore. So yes, absolutely, over time, system two thinking can become system one thinking. An even better example of this, Shivani and the other person who asked this question, think about it this way. When people tell you to do mindful eating, and this relates to an earlier question as well, what we are basically telling you to do is you might want to engage system two thinking when you eat food. Sitting in front of a TV and eating food is something that all of us indulge in, whether we like it or not, but perhaps it's not a healthy habit to have. If you engage system two while you're eating, you're likely to have a much better meal. And who knows, maybe you might end up eating lesser as well. So yes, system two thinking can become system one thinking, but sometimes it is better for us to train our minds to engage system two thinkings when we're listening to a song, when we're eating a meal, when we're watching a movie, rather than try and say, okay, in the background, the movie is playing, but let me check my Twitter feed or my WhatsApp messages while watching the movie. Then we are engaging in system one behavior with the movie is concerned. We're not giving it the full benefit of our attention. For the purpose of trying to finish all of the slides that I have, I'm unfortunately going to have to go away from the questions right now. But once the 40 minutes are over, I promise I'll come back and try and answer as many questions as you guys have. So let me go back to the presentation. I'm not sure if I'm still sharing it. So okay, hopefully this is visible now. And let me proceed with the remaining slides. One of my favorite examples of behavioral economics and how difficult it is to think through things. This is an example entirely due to Dan Ariely. It's not my own original example. And the bottom of the slide has a link where you can read more about this. Let me explain what is going on over here. So So Dan, I really came across this advertisement for the Economist magazine and he found it fascinating. What are we looking at? We're looking at three options. The economist.com subscription is for $59. This gives you online access to all articles from The Economist. Okay. The print subscription is $125. And what this gives you is 1 year subscription only to the print edition. Or for $125, you can take the print and web subscription, which gives you the Economist magazine delivered at home. Plus you get access to everything online. What I'm going to ask all of you to do, don't message your responses in the chat window, but just think about it on the basis of what I've just described. And assuming you could afford, money wasn't a problem, then which of the three offers seems best to you? Either you can take the online only for $59, or you can take the print only for $125, or you can take print and web for $125. I'm guessing, I don't know, but I'm guessing most of you would have picked, assuming money wasn't a problem, the print and web subscription. Because like me, most of you would have thought, well, okay, for 125, I'm getting print or print and web, then you might as well take print and web. This is exactly what the economist.com magazine wants you to say. What Dan really did is he took the same advertisement into a class, but with one important difference, he removed the option in the middle. So then it was only $59 for online or $125 for web and print. When the middle option was removed, then many more people chose online only. When the middle option was kept there, many people chose print and web. The middle option, print only, was a decoy. It was kept there simply to make print and web subscriptions seem more attractive. And if right now you're thinking, I could never fall for something like this, this is not a problem that would ever occur in my life. Remember the time when before the pandemic started, before COVID-19 took over our entire existence, we could walk into movie theaters. And in movie theaters, you have the option to buy a small tub of popcorn, a medium tub of popcorn, or a large tub of popcorn. I'm just using random examples, but let's imagine that the small tub of popcorn costs 100 rupees, medium tub of popcorn costs 190 rupees, and the large tub of popcorn costs 200 rupees. So small for 100, medium for 190, and large for 200. Almost everybody is going to think, well, if I'm getting a large tub of popcorn by paying only 10 rupees more, then let's buy the large tub of popcorn. You've fallen prey to the decoy effect. A completely irrelevant line has led you to change your choice. In other words, you've fallen prey to the environment around you. Does this happen? Very much so. So whenever the pandemic ends and we're able to go back and watch a movie in the movie theater, if you find yourself sitting after the interval with a very large tub of popcorn, unfortunately, you've fallen prey to behavioral economics. And it just works in fascinating ways in endless scenarios. Tomorrow's class, I'll give you many more such examples. In fact, we will give each other such examples, but there are plenty of examples of how we fall prey to things around us and end up spending more money than we would ideally have liked to. This is a slightly complicated diagram to explain. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to explain this diagram by moving on to an example and then coming back to this diagram. So don't worry, I will come back to the slide, but let's take a look. Let's take a look at the next slide first. So please choose and make a note yourself right now of which of the two would you prefer. I can either give you $250 right away, or you can choose option B. Option B gives you a 25% chance to win $1,000, or there's a 75% chance that you'll win nothing. Will you choose option A or will you choose option B? Please don't unmute yourself and answer the question. All I'm asking you to do is make a note of what choice you'll take. I'll wait for a couple of seconds. And now, take a look at the second experiment. Will you choose a certain loss of $750? Or we'll choose a 75% chance to lose $1,000 and a 25% chance to lose nothing. again, I'll wait for a couple of seconds. If you had to choose, if I said that no, you can't leave class until you have chosen one of A and B from the first and one of C and D from the second, which options would you choose? Now, statisticians and mathematicians in this class should ideally be saying right now, hey, boss, they're the same answer. So expectation theory, basic probability. In option A, I'm saying 250. In option B, I'm saying 25% multiplied by 1,000 and 75% multiplied by 0. That's also 250. Similarly, in option 2, 750 is option C, whereas option D is 75% multiplied by 1,000. The expectation is 750 and 25% multiplied by 0 is 0. But I'm guessing most of you still chose, and I'm also guessing that most of you chose A and D. Why did you choose A and D? Because most of us are hardwired to take gains for sure. Certain win of 250 is better than a 25% chance to win $1,000. And similarly, the risk of losing 1,000 with a 75% chance is better than losing 750 for sure. I might be wrong about this, but I'm fairly certain, and in fact, it would be very surprising if on this call, the vast majority had chosen differently. Most people will choose A and D. Now, if you understand the fact that you've chosen A and D, then this diagram begins to make sense. What we are saying is the prospect of losing gives us more fear than the prospect of winning gives us happiness. Let me say that again. The prospect of losing generates more fear in us than the prospect of winning generates happiness. If you will notice this S curve, it is not symmetrical. It's flatter over here and it's steeper over here. Basically, what I'm saying is losses hurt more than gains give pleasure. Let me say that again. Losses hurt more than gains give pleasure, which is exactly why over here we chose option A and option B. We want to avoid a loss because a loss hurts more. And when it comes to gain, we want certainty. Let me give you a very appropriate and perhaps slightly uncomfortable example of what we mean when we say we will choose certainty. It's almost unholy fascination that Indian society has with getting a sarkari nokri, a government job. What is that? It is basically getting some sort of guaranteed income. Because as when we were growing up, most of us are told by our parents that the best thing to do is to get a government job. Why were we told this? Because of the way this S-shaped curve, looks. It is because we want the safety of getting $250. We will discourage our children from starting startups. We will discourage our children from taking risks. We will say, boss, please don't take arts. Please take science. Why? Because it is more certain that you will gain. Prospect theory helps us understand why human beings are wired in such a way that we tend to take gains for certain and why we tend to avoid losses as much as possible. It is not symmetrical at all. Our decision making under certainty and what we do when it comes to gains and losses, all of us are wired in such a way that we want safety and guarantee. And we will do whatever it can, whatever can be done in order to avoid losses. This, what I just described, is prospect theory at work. Prospect theory is one of the most fundamental insights in modern behavioral economics, and it was due to Kahneman and Tversky, the two people you saw in that particular photograph. This was one of their first breakthroughs when it came to how to understand behavioral economics better. Another thing that they came up with was this particular example, Linda. So please read this. So which is more probable? Option one, Linda is a bank teller. Option two, Linda is a bank teller and is active in the feminist movement. this is not my question. Anybody who's familiar with behavioral economics will tell you this is one of the most original questions that Kahneman and Tversky asked. So again, don't answer either in the chat window or by unmuting yourself, but please try and figure out which answer you think works best, that Linda is a bank teller or that Linda is a bank teller and is active in the feminist movement. Again, I'll wait for a couple of seconds. Now, what is the correct answer? Like me, perhaps you're also tempted to say option two is more correct because, okay, she's a bank teller, but all of what we have read about over here, issues of discrimination, social justice, and participation in anti-nuclear demonstrations, all of this also seems to suggest that Linda is active in the feminist movement. But basic probability is being violated over here. If I define option one as probability of A, and option two as probability of A intersection probability of B, because that's an AND statement, then by definition, two must be less likely than one. But most of us, based on the information given to us, tend to go with option two rather than option one. This is we reacting to the environment around us, we reaching a judgment based on system one thinking. What all of us did, if we chose option two, is we said, all right, I don't want to think deeply about the laws of probability right now. I just want to react to information that has been given to me. If she's deeply concerned with issues of discrimination and social justice, if she's participated in anti-nuclear demonstrations, then it's almost a guarantee that she's active in the feminist movement. If we had not restricted ourselves to system one thinking, if we had told system two in our brain, "Ki boss, you solve this problem," then perhaps system two in our brain would have said, hang on a second, probability of A intersection B will by definition be lesser than probability of A. So let's not go with option two. Option one is always safer. If you studied probability, you know that what I'm saying is right. But the only way our brain understands this is by deploying system two. But we tend to not deploy system two. Our brains are inherently lazy, which is just another way of saying they're very efficient. System 2 only wakes up when there is a real urgent need. The problem is, it is our brain who decides what is a real urgent need. And that ends up allowing us to make many more mistakes than we would have. Linda is a classic way of understanding the difference between System 1 and System 2 thinking. What I'm about to show you right now is one of my all-time favorite examples. This example in behavioral economics comes from Dan Ariely. It's a lovely, lovely story. So what is the story? This is the story. It turns out that like we have the RTO in India, the place where you go to get licenses. Similarly, when you go to Denmark, Netherlands, United Kingdom, Germany, Austria, Belgium, all the countries that you can see over here, when you go to their RTO or their Department of Motor Vehicles, call it whatever you want, when you go there and you apply for a license, you have to fill out a form. In that form, you have to say that if in the unfortunate event that you are in an accident, you lose your life, are you okay donating your organs? Okay, so in that form, when you apply for a license, you have to say, are you okay donating your organs if you lose your life in an accident or not? What you see for Denmark, Netherlands, United Kingdom, and Germany are the percentage of people who said, yes, I want to donate my organs. It was 4.25% in Denmark, 17.17% in United Kingdom, 12% in Germany. Netherlands was so upset with how low its numbers were that they ran a concerted campaign to make people more aware of the issue, and that is why they were able to push it up to 27.5%. Some of you might be wondering, well, what about Austria, Belgium, France, Hungary, Poland, Portugal, and Sweden? These are their response rates. As you can see, the lowest amongst them is 86%. Even the lowest amongst them, 86%, is still more than three times as much as the highest amongst the yellow bars. Now there's a problem. What is it about a group of otherwise similar nations, mostly the same ethnicity, definitely the same neighborhood, in some cases shared languages, a shared religion? In many regards, they are very, very common to each other. But in this one regard, effective consent percentage, there's a world of a difference between the two. And so economists and policymakers were faced with a problem. what is the difference between these two countries? Turns out the difference between these two countries was almost painfully obvious once you thought about it from the perspective of behavioral economics. What happened is, for Austria, Belgium, France, Hungary, Poland, Portugal, and Sweden, what the form said is the following. You are a part of the organ donation program. Tick here if you don't want to be a part. So by default, they were in the program. They had to tick to opt out. In the case of Denmark, Netherlands, United Kingdom, and Germany, the statement was something like this. Tick here if you want to be a part of the program. By default, it was opt out. You had to tick to get in. Once Denmark, Netherlands, United Kingdom, and Germany changed the form, and they said, by default, you are in. Tick here if you want to opt out. Their percentages also went up to 90%. It might sound strange and unbelievable, but human beings were being lazy and just not ticking. In one group of countries, not ticking made you part of the program. In another group of countries, not ticking made you not a part of the program. And the reason I find this amazing, and the reason why I almost always enjoy sharing this story with people, is because people were not selfish. Who you were, which nationality you belong to, did not impact your attitude towards organ donation. It was simply the fact that all human beings in both the blue countries and the yellow countries, they were just lazy. They chose to not tick. If you change what happens when you don't tick, you can get people to do what you want them to do. And if you think this is an abstract example, I prepared this slide literally around 3 hours ago. So I just logged on to my app on my phone for Zomato, and I just created this order page. But as you might see at the top of the screen, barbecue chicken wrap is what I said, okay, chalo, I want to order this. The reason I'm showing you this example is because if you take a look at the bottom of the screen, it says more instructions, don't send cutlery. If you tick this box, then the restaurant will not send you any plastic cutlery. If you don't tick the box, then the restaurant will send it to you. Now, in the year 2018, when I conducted a behavioral economics workshop at the Gokhale Institute, a faculty member from Pune University, she said, why don't we write to Zomato and say, make this the opt-in? Okay, by default, we will not send cutlery. If you want, then you tick the box, and that way we will send the cutlery. It's a classic example of default opt-in and default opt-out. You can think of it in terms of licenses over here in Europe. You can think of it in examples of Ashish ordering food. You can think of it in examples of when you sign up on a new website. You remember the little box that says, tick here if you don't want to receive updates from us? Of course, nobody ticks that box, and that is why the spam folder in our inbox exists. So whether it is emails that we don't want to read, whether it is plastic cutlery that we're going to throw out as soon as we get it, whether it is organ donations in the case of Europe. Unfortunately, all of these are examples of how we can nudge people to do exactly what we want them to do, just if we get the environment right. Go back to Herbert Simon and think about how Herbert Simon said cognitive load and the structure of the environment is what helps us decide how to react to the world around us. If we are able to change the environment, we might be able to nudge people into taking much better decisions. So somebody on the chat window had asked about sugar and kids in Britain. So sugar and kids in Britain, what you're looking at on this slide, what you're looking at on this slide, all of these are examples of how we can nudge people to take better decisions. Now, my sincerest apologies, it's not just what is written on the slide, but I'm apologizing to you right now. Hopefully all of you can hear me loud and clear. What I'm about to show you is a slightly distasteful picture. It's not going to be the best thing to see on a Saturday afternoon. And again, my apologies in advance. But the reason I'm going to show you this is one of the most powerful nudges that has been used in multiple places the world over. It was first used, if memory serves me right, in Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam. And again, with the caveat that I'm apologizing, this is what I wanted to show you. This is obviously a men's urinal. And men's urinals are seen the world over. But what I want to show you is the picture of the fly because it is quite literally a picture or a sticker of the fly. The fly isn't real. But this and the article from which I've taken this photograph is shown in the slide below. You can click on it and read the article once I share the presentation with you. What the fly does is it helps you aim at the fly. And when you aim at the fly, spillage outside the bowl tends to not happen. Bathrooms are cleaner, sanitation is higher, diseases are lower. You can put up n number of messages, and the gentleman on this call will have seen those messages in men's washrooms. Please stand closer to the bowl, your aim will help, and so on and so forth. Turns out, the best thing to do is to ask men to aim at the fly. Once you aim at the fly, you by definition are forced to make sure that there is no spillage. And I'm not joking about this. This little trick has been used in multiple places the world over and has created massive health upsides. Another related story. In Singapore, I traveled to Singapore in the year 2016, and it's still a major source of regret to me that I didn't take a photograph of this. But if you walk into subway stations in Singapore and use the restroom or the washroom, after you wash your hands and you're about to leave, they, at least back then, used to have a picture of a baby on the back door of the washroom. So you've gone to the washroom, you've done whatever you had to, you've washed your hands and you're ready to leave the washroom. There used to be a picture of a baby with his hands up like this, as if he's waiting for, or she's waiting for you to pick up the baby. And below there was a simple message, have you washed your hands? Now I can say, have you washed your hands? But if I say, have you washed your hands, and I put in your head the idea that you have to pick up a baby after you leave the washroom, then you're going to make sure that you washed your hands. That's an example of nudging people to do what you want them to. There are, once you begin to think of nudges, you can't stop but you can't help but see a million different nudges in the world around you. Here is another example. This is from the same article, the BBC article. And what this shows you is pictures of children painted on the awnings or the security covers or the grates in front of shops. So why paint pictures of these babies? Simple. What you're looking at is a riot-prone area in London. So this was an area that was disturbed and there were frequent riots and shops would be destroyed during those riots. The British authorities did a very simple thing. They painted pictures of babies on the shop awnings. And even if you're a rioter who's angry and you want to throw a stone or a Molotov cocktail or you want to take a bat and break down the shop, something humane in all of us which makes us not want to hurt a child. Of course, you're not hurting a child. This is not a real painting. But I challenge any one of you on the call to be able to not feel a little bad if you take a look at the eyes, especially in this photograph, and then decide, no, I still want to break the shop down. It actually worked. The number of fatalities and the number of rioting incidents came down as a consequence of just pictures of children being painted on covers of shops. There are multiple other examples that I can give you. One of my favorite ones comes from the city of Bombay, where people were trying to convince, or authorities were trying to convince people to not cross the railway tracks. The best thing that worked was showing photos of what happens to you if a train runs over your legs while you're trying to cross the railway tracks. So this is dangerous, alert, don't do it, didn't work. If you do this, then this is what your leg might look like. That actually worked. That's an example of a nudge. So it's one thing to understand that we are going to be influenced by our environment from a policy perspective. And this is, in a sense, why Richard Thaler won his Nobel Prize. What you want to understand is, if you are going to be impacted by those factors that I spoke about at the start of this presentation, how can we use that information to drive society towards a better end? Another example of behavioral economics is a phrase that is beloved of venture capitalists the world over, FOMO. This stands for fear of missing out. If you've ever caught yourself waiting for a flash sale of smartphones on the Amazon or the Flipkart app, or if you have fallen prey to buying something during the Prime Day sale or the Big Billion Day sale or whatever it is, because you fear missing out, oh, this offer is there only for 2 days, let's make use of this offer, otherwise it won't be there tomorrow. We don't ask whether we need whatever it is that we've ordered. We just want to order it. Why do we want to order it? The reason we want to order it is because, hey, the opportunity will go away in, say, for example, 1 day. So what if the opportunity goes away? We didn't want it in the first place. Is not something that most of us think about. And as a consequence, we are able to trick people into buying stuff they don't need. The gentleman who asked the question about Gandhian economics, this is how, sir, you might be able to use behavioral economics to convince people to not engage in the fear of missing out. If only we can educate people that, you know what, not every sale has to result in you buying something, then perhaps people will indulge in lesser of ostentatious consumption-led behavior. Easier said than done, of course, doesn't always work out, but behavioral economics might have useful tips about how to engineer a world in which more people subscribe to Gandhian values. The final example that I'm going to speak about before we go on to questions is temporal irrationality. What is temporal irrationality? There are many examples that I can give you of temporal irrationality. Let me give you my favorite one. Today in the state of Maharashtra, which is where I am from, is the festival of Ganesh Chaturthi. So there is a dish made in Maharashtra called Modaks, which is very popular. But think of any sweet that you like. One of my favorite sweets happens to be Gulab Jamuns. So imagine that I, Ashish Kulkarni, have just finished lunch and now I'm going to have desserts. Should I have desserts or not? And if I have desserts, then should I have only one Gulab Jamun or 10? Now, if you ask Ashish, the 38-year-old, which is my age right now, Ashish, should you have one Gulab Jam or five Gulab Jams after lunch? If you're anything like me, your answer is going to be five Gulab Jams. Why have only one? I have five. But you know what? If I stay alive until the age of 70, 70-year-old Ashish might wish that he had a time machine so that he could come back and tell 38-year-old Ashish, don't have those five Gulab Jams. Your health, 32 years down the line, is going to be much worse. Eat healthy. Don't just have the Gulab Jams. In fact, have only vegetables for lunch. What am I saying? I'm saying that myself 32 years down the line and myself today, we have two completely different ideas about what is good and bad for us. But the human brain is hardwired to think only of the present. We don't do effective time value discounting. We don't value the future as much as we should. And that's all of us. If there are students on this call, then ideally you should not be watching that movie on Netflix. You should be spending the next 3 hours reading a book. Why? Because 40-year-old you might say, thank God you read the book rather than watch the movie that allowed you to score good marks, get a good job, and therefore you're much better off right now. But 21-year-old you says, forget it, I'll read the book tomorrow. Right now, let's watch that movie. We tend to not handle long-term future plans very well. We are focused on the present. Another example of how our minds end up being unfortunately more irrational than we would like them to be. Now, if I've managed to whet your appetites, if I've managed to make you slightly hungry for how else can I learn about behavioral economics, then I have about 8 books that I would love to recommend for you to read. Doesn't mean that you have to read every single one of them. But if you're looking for books that will help you understand behavioral economics better, then these are the books that I would love to recommend. The first of which is Predictably Irrational by Dan Ariely. Second, Michael Lewis, the same guy who wrote Liar's Poker, a book called Moneyball, a book called The Big Short, both of which became very good movies in their own right. He's also written a book called The Undoing Project, which is about the friendship between Amos Tversky and Daniel Kahneman. Lovely book to read. Michael Lewis is a brilliant writer. I would heavily recommend that you read this book. Another book by Dan Ariely, The Upside of Irrationality, about how sometimes defying logic actually makes the world a better place. Most people who tell you to read a book about behavioral economics will speak about thinking fast and slow. I'm going to be slightly controversial over here and say that you shouldn't read this book right away. First, read the other books. This is not me criticizing Daniel Kahneman. The book is fantastic. It's easily the best book that you can read about behavioral economics, but it's a very difficult book to digest. Not because it is a lot of math or diagrams, but because Daniel Kahneman has thought so very thoroughly and carefully about the book that you deserve to, or rather you need to, read each and every sentence very carefully. I've read the book easily more than 4 or 5 times now, but I still benefit by rereading the book, and I never read the book in a single stretch. I take my time and read a couple of pages every now and then and think deep and hard about them. So do read the book, but don't make it the first book that you'll read about behavioral economics. This is in a way the book that more than any other book helped Richard Thaler win the Nobel Prize, with Cass Sunstein. brilliant book about examples that I have been speaking about in today's class, and many more examples besides of how to nudge people into taking better decisions. Those of you who are interested in learning more about behavioral finance, which is a subset of behavioral economics, this I think is easily one of the best books that you can read, Inefficient Markets, an Introduction to Behavioral Finance. I will be speaking more about this in tomorrow's class. My personal favorite book to read, this is sort of an intellectual autobiography of Richard Thaler's work. Great book. So this is about misbehaving and how Thaler became who he was. For those of you who are academically minded, the Anomalies column, A-N-O-M-A-L-I-E-S, in the Journal of Economic Perspectives, used to be written by Thaler in the late 1980s. Great collection of columns about how the world behaved in surprising and unexpected ways. And at least specifically about the last slide that I showed you about temporal irrationality, but in general about how to think about happiness. This is a book written by a Harvard-based psychologist, Daniel Gilbert. It teaches you how to think academically about that mysterious but very real thing, happiness. So if you're looking for, like I said, books to read, then perhaps you might want to start with these 8 books. Of course, there are more books and many more papers, but this is a good introduction to the subject. All right. Thank you so much for listening so patiently. That's all I had in terms of the presentation. And now hopefully we have time to answer as many questions as possible. Okay. It seems there are a whole host of questions over here, so I'll try and deal with them as we go along. Feel free to continue to add to these questions in the chat window. I think the session lasts until 4:15, so we'll keep on going until 4:15 and we'll answer as many questions as we possibly can. So Arun Kumar has a question about how we can relate individual studies with public policies. Arun, I'm not avoiding the question right now, but I will try to answer your question in a sense by speaking for about 2 hours tomorrow. Are these biases systematic? Do many more people respond in a systematic way to a given environment? And if so, can we make some sort of prediction about larger groups than just the individual? Is effectively the topic of tomorrow's talk. Shivali, I'm sorry, you had asked the question at 3:07, but because I could see only my screen, I don't remember now which book it is that I was speaking about. But hopefully the recording will be made available to all participants and you should be able to decipher which book it was. Just in case you're not able to, I am sharing my email address at the end of today's talk. Drop me an email and we'll try and figure out which book it was. All right, Deepa Mariam Alexander asks, the neoclassical optimization consumption and theory sounds like a long shot when thought of from the BE perspective. Absolutely, 100%. I completely agree with you. I don't think anybody actually does optimization the way neoclassical economics speaks about it. That being said, in the defense of neoclassical economics, what they're really saying is, I might not be able to get it exactly right from an individual perspective, but the errors will average out over society. So their defense, the people who believe that neoclassical economics is still necessarily only the right way of looking at the world, they are saying, sure, every now and then there may be errors on part of people, but if you study 100, 1,000, 10,000 people together, then optimization still works. I personally don't agree with that defense. I agree with you, Deepa, when you say that, yes, this also sounds like a long shot. Oh, so David has already answered the question that Shivali had placed. It is, yes, Small is Beautiful by E.F. Schumacher, and it's a great book to read. So Stevie has another question. Are the two systems of thinking related to cognitive and affective components of attitude? Yes, you can also think of them as the impartial spectator from Adam Smith. Of course, there is no, if you were to cut up a human brain, you're not going to see two different system one and system two thinking. So Kahneman is very clear in his book, Thinking Fast and Slow, that this is a metaphor, an example that he uses. This is not necessarily how the human brain is structured. It's a framework that we put on top of it. But to answer your question, yes, absolutely, it is related to the cognitive and affective components of attitude. Antony asks the question, is cognitive limitation and paradox of choice the same thing? Not the same thing, sir, but they're very closely related to each other. Manan Joshi had a question, which book to read for starters? Hopefully, I've already answered that question, Manan, in the last slide of the presentation. I've recommended 8 books. So long as you don't pick Thinking Fast and Slow first, pick any book and that should work. Mallika has what I think is a very difficult question, which is why I'm laughing. Is irrationality from one perspective rational from another perspective? Honestly, I don't know how to answer that question, Mallika. And the reason I say I don't know how to answer the question is because not just from an economist viewpoint, but more importantly, from a philosophical viewpoint, this takes us into very deep waters. Basically, what you're asking is, do we live in an objective world where deontology takes precedence over everything else? And short answer to your question is, I don't know. So Manan Joshi asks, I have read Nudge, but want a more textbook experience. In that case, Manan, either Thinking Fast and Slow, or if you're looking for an application-oriented textbook, then Schleifer's book is a very good book. All right, Robin Abraham asks a question, how can we relate behavioral economics with consumer behavior? Sheila Iyengar has a lovely book, Robin, called The Art of Choosing. Let me repeat the name, Sheila Iyengar, I-Y-E-N-G-A-R. And the name of the book is The Art of Choosing. It's a great book to read about how to think about behavioral economics and consumer behavior. Okay, Swayam Shri has a question. How would the policymaker affect system 1 and system 2 of brain systems? Swayam Shri, the point isn't that we will affect system 1 and system 2 of brain systems. In fact, as I just mentioned, there are no system 1 and system 2 decipherable in your brains. But can we use the fact that most people will use system 1 thinking to push them into taking better decisions? So if you've heard of the Nudge behavioral unit in especially the United Kingdom, it's a great setup to understand how to get people to respond the way you want them to. Rajendra Deshpande continues his point about Gandhian economics by saying he was the first to speak about economics or econometrics. In either case, Mr. Deshpande, I would say no. Mahatma Gandhi was not the first person to speak about economics, but he was certainly the person who popularized, especially in India, the concept of, you can refer to it as Gandhian economics or Buddhist economics. So that credit is certainly due to Mahatma Gandhi, again, in my opinion. Does behavioral economics base itself on the notion of free markets? It doesn't base itself on the notion of free markets, Mr. Matthew, but however, it is closely dependent on people being free to choose. Because of course, if you're not free to choose, then errors in choosing or irrationality in choosing will not crop up in the first place. Lori Yadav asks the question, how is BE different from psychology? It isn't different from psychology. It is, in a sense, the marriage of psychology and economics. So if you want to study behavioral economics in depth, I would strongly suggest being aware of basic economics, but also being aware of basic psychology. So pick any classic textbook from the field if you're an economics student, but certainly be aware of the basic concepts in ecologies, and you should have a more than passing familiarity with, say, for example, Skinner, Freud, Jung, and be aware of the major theories and also a certain grasp of modern psychological techniques. Okay, Deepa has a request about the concept of bounded rationality and suggest a reading list for beginners. So Deepa, I've hopefully been able to answer the second part of your question. Focusing on bounded rationality, the reason I couldn't do it is because there were so many other things that I wanted to speak about where behavioral economics is concerned. But if you just read the Nobel Prize website on Herbert Simon, or if you read the Wikipedia article on Herbert Simon, that's a pretty good place to start to understand more about bounded rationality. Nidhi asked about a reading list for beginners, and again, hopefully I have been able to answer that particular question. Shivani says, Starbucks uses the decoy effect very prominently. Absolutely, 100% agree with you. Prospect theory, casino example, yes, Manan. So far, there are no questions, except Shantanu Mitra says, the reason for the choices is the convexities of the value function. Sure. So it is a function of the convexity of the value function, except you might want to go a level deeper and ask, why are they convex to begin with? But from a mathematical perspective, 100% agree with you. Okay, a lot of responses to those two questions. Shivani, yes, the representative heuristic, but I will speak about this in much greater detail in tomorrow's class. Preeti Gupta has a question about the use of behavioral economics in health sector. A whole variety of things, Preeti. You might think about, say, for example, the men's union example that I gave you. You can think of the Singapore example that I gave you. You can think of how we can use behavioral nudges to encourage more people to wear masks, and so on and so forth. It's, I mean, endless examples of economics in the health sector. If you have a more specific question, drop me an email. I'll try and send you some academic references. Shivani, yes, absolutely. The five rupee donation box is marked, but not just in MMT, and a whole host of other apps as well, including Zomato. Shivani also has an excellent point. Printing pictures of affected lungs on cigarette pics does not lead to quit smoking. Sure, it doesn't. So neither I nor anybody else is saying that behavioral economics is a magic wand that works perfectly. Think of it as a spectrum. Might it be the case that out of, say, maybe 1 million people in India who smoke, at least one person is affected by that photograph? And worst case scenario, even if not one person is affected by this photograph while he or she is a smoker, might such photographs stop you from becoming a smoker in the first place? So is it as effective as you would want it to be if you wanted to stop smoking? Absolutely not. But does it have potential, and is there basically no downside? I would argue yes. And as Vimal John said, yes, this generation smokes a lot lesser than their parents' generation. Although, of course, the econometrician in me, Mr. John, forces me to say, you know what, perhaps there are other factors at play as well. But I would still be in favor of putting those photographs on cigarette packets. Again, Vimal John asks a very interesting question. Is a question of ethics involved when we talk about nudges? Very much so, sir. So Thaler himself, by the way, has an excellent essay defending the concept of libertarian, it's a big word, libertarian paternalism. But basically, libertarians are always saying, hey, you know what, saying that healthy salad choices here is not all that good an idea, because you're pushing people into doing something that perhaps they didn't want to. How is that fair? Which is an example of the kind of ethics question that you were speaking about. Thaler's, I'll give you the one sentence defense that Thaler would give. Read his entire essay, and I'll provide a link to it in tomorrow's class. He says, well, all right, if we are not giving the nudge, a lot of nudges are being given whether we like it or not. So the fact that you've put up three aisles of food for a person at a buffet table, that in itself is a nudge. You're nudging people to eat more. Are you able to remove every single nudge from the world? And if not, then why defend only one kind of nudge? Would be my preliminary response to what you've said. But yes, questions of ethics are definitely involved. Okay, after this, a lot of compliments, and thank you so much for those compliments. And now we have a question from Shankar P. Does this pandemic period really mean that those who are in need of good medical facilities without thinking of any behavioral rationality regarding it? I think the current time is a very good time, sir, to encourage people to, say, practice more social distancing effectively, encouraging people to wear masks, encouraging people to go to the hospital if they think they have symptoms. In each of these cases, effective nudges can and should be used. So to give a very simple example, what about if, say, for example, in supermarkets, we can put pictures of elderly people and young children holding their hands up in prayer saying, please wash your hands. Might that work better than a simple message, sanitize yourself? So I think there are lots of opportunities available right now for using nudges, especially during the times of the coronavirus crisis, to push people into better health practices. Anuradha, books for graduate students, doesn't matter what age you are, those 8 books to me are a very good place to start, with the simple recommendation that maybe you want to pick up Thinking Fast and Slow slightly later. Pritish, when it comes to choice architecture and paternalism, as you probably yourself are aware, there are hundreds and thousands of better examples. I will be speaking about some of them tomorrow. So please wait for tomorrow's session. I will cover this in greater detail. Behavioral economics and standard economics are complementary to each other in the sense, Mahindra, that you really don't want to think of a world that is either saying behavioral economics is wrong and classical economics is right, or vice versa. I think there is a spectrum where both can coexist. And the person who I think did more than any other person to think about this better was Herbert Simon. In tomorrow's class, I'll share a link to a video that I would recommend that you watch. This is a very friendly debate between Eugene Fama and Richard Thaler, one of whom believes very strongly in behavioral economics. That's Thaler, of course. The other person doesn't at all. Is neuroeconomics a part of behavioral economics? Is asked by Corinne Abraham. Yes, it very much is. In fact, one of my PhD students at the Gokhale Institute is currently working on neuroeconomics. Early days yet. This is just her first 6 months into this particular subject. But this is something that both she and I hope to work a little bit more on in the years to come. Short answer, yes, it's very much a part of behavioral economics. Okay, Mohammad Nasi has a fascinating question. What about macroeconomics and behaviorism? Are there any advances done in this field? Yes and no. I'm not avoiding the question right now, but I will be speaking briefly about this in tomorrow's class. But the short answer to your question, Mr. Mohammad Nasi, is yes, there are advances, but it's much easier to do this in micro than it is in macro. Is there any work of behavioral economics in agriculture? Not an area of expertise for me right now, Mr. Sanjay, but I'll try and look this up. If I can find any good papers, I'll share them with you. But for the moment, no, I don't know. Kinjal, yes, the TED Talk by Sheila Iyengar is also a very good TED Talk. And feel free to share the link if you want in the chat window so that other people can also take a look at it. Abhijit asks, when it comes to risk lovers and risk averse people, so basically the Arrow-Pratt theorem, if you're familiar with microeconomics, people such as John Cochrane will say that effectively Thaler or Kahneman or Tversky haven't come up with something brand new. They will say that this basically is the Arrow-Pratt theorem at play. I tend to disagree a little bit and say that no, there is a slightly deeper understanding involved when it comes to prospect theory. But to answer your question very quickly right now, Abhijit, they are very, very, very closely related. Okay. Arun Kumar has a question, Behavioral Economics by Cartwright. Yes, that's also a good book. So please don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that there are only these 8 books. There are many others besides. I just happen to choose those 8 right now. But many other books are also there. Okay, maybe one more question and then we can stop for today. There are a lot of questions over here. Let me just pick one. Let me pick one that is interesting. Okay, let's end with the one that Harish PM has asked. Can BE make changes in policy making? Absolutely. And tomorrow's class is just going to be full of examples of how we use fallacies, biases, and heuristics to make changes in policy. That's tomorrow's class. All right. Thank you so much for waiting the full 2 hours on a Saturday afternoon. It's a big commitment on your part. I really appreciate it. And I hope to see most of you tomorrow as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. It was indeed a great introduction to behavioral economics. And tomorrow we will have again another session from Dr. Kulkarni. The same time, 2:15 p.m. on the topic, decision making under uncertainty, heuristics and biases. Right. The attendance link is in our chat box. Kindly fill the attendance form also. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. It was highly interactive and it was a mind-blowing session and we all enjoyed very well. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you all dear participants, the academicians, the researchers, the students, the professors from various parts of our country. Thank you very much. And also abroad participants are there. Thank you very much. Thank you, one and all.
Email address in the chat window. Feel free to reach out if you think I can help you out in any way. Right. Thank you so much. I'll see you tomorrow at 2:15.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.